meeting with the Adult Social Care and Public Health Committee. You should all know that this meeting will be webcast and the record will be retained on the council website for up to 2 years. If you participate in this meeting, you are consenting with your name and the contents of what you say, and your image will be broadcast and stored to the council website. And if any of you have any problems with that, any concerns, please contact our committee services office at the meeting. If you are at home viewing this webcast, if you look above the video, you'll see a resources tab. If you click on this, it will link to the agenda, and you can open the agenda in the PDF form, and that will help you to follow the discussion and debate. Right, so given that we're all considerably warmer than we were the last time we were in this room, do we have any apologies for absence? And we have declarations of interest, please. All right. Pretty much everywhere, you see, that's the nature of this committee, isn't it? We'll start over there, Councillor Hickey.
I've got the NHS.
Thank you. I'm
I'm an employee of Cheshire Rural Partnership NHS Foundation Trust.
Close family member who works for the NHS.
I work for the NHS, my son works for the NHS, and I'm a trustee of Inter Babies.
Thank you, Chair. So I'm a senior partner of the Netherlands Medical Centre, which is a general practice in Woodchurch. I'm also the medical secretary of the Mersey Local Medical Committee and the GC Rep for Cheshire and Inter Babies, and trustee of Inter Babies as well now. Thank you.
Thank you, Chair. I'm quite privileged.
I am a governor of Glasgow Cancer Centre and also of Cheshire Mother Partnership. With the normal huge list of interests, and we'll move on to the minutes of meeting. Both meetings held on the 11th and 24th of October. Can we approve the accuracy of those minutes? Can I have a move and second to Councillor Jordan and Councillor Camford? Thank you. Right, we have takes us on into public questions, statements and petitions. I'm aware that we have questions from Mr. Brace. You can be able to ask your questions.
Shall I just ask each one and then you give an answer rather than it's a block? Would that be easier?
By all means.
Okay. So question one is, the Autism Act 2009 requires the Minister to set out a strategy known as the Autism Strategy for meeting the needs of adults in England with autism spectrum disorders by improving the provision of relevant services to such adults in England by local authorities such as Royal Council. There is associated guidance to the Autism Strategy published by the Minister and issued to Royal Council as to how it exercises its social services function. In relation to that guidance, can you answer how Royal Council specifically tailors its social services functions for adults with an autism spectrum disorder in the following seven areas? A, the provision of relevant services for the purpose of diagnosing autistic spectrum conditions in adults. B, the identification of adults with such conditions. C, the assessment of the needs of adults with such conditions for relevant services. D, planning in relation to the provision of relevant services to persons with autistic spectrum conditions as they move from being children to adults. E, other planning in relation to the provision of relevant services to adults with autistic spectrum conditions. F, the training of staff who provide relevant services to adults with such conditions. And G, local arrangements for leadership in relation to the provision of relevant services to adults with such conditions.
Right, thank you for that one, Mr. Brace. And I have been advised by the director that we will send you a written response to that because it is a very detailed question. And that response will be circulated to all members of the committee as well. But you will get a response. But it was very detailed. I was trying to give you an answer here and now. But please do carry on with the questions.
Yes, right. I'm sure you have my email address to send out two is, with regards to services provided to adults by Royal Council on interest expected from its social services side, subject to a financial assessment for which Royal Council charges a fee, what ways, if any, are either the financial assessments or invoicing, if applicable, communicated in a way that makes it easier and more comprehensible for those on the autistic spectrum, bearing in mind it impacts communication for the service user to understand it so that they can respond to related communications in a meaningful way?
I don't I'm advised that you'll get a written response to that one as well, and it will also be circulated to the committee. You may get more response now, question three, because I can do that one.
Yeah, I'll have to turn over the page for questions, please, that might be important, but I think. At the moment, adults who live on the Wirral are being assessed by Wirral Council Social Services and needing X hours of care a week, but they're not receiving this care due to a shortage of capacity of people working in social care locally. So the care needed, unfortunately, can't be commissioned by Wirral Council or its local NHS partners. What is Wirral Council currently doing to encourage people to work in the area of social care, and when does it estimate the total local capacity of the social care workforce will be better aligned with the needs of the Wirral population?
Thanks for that one, Mr. Grace, but it's certainly an issue that we have been addressing. You will get a formal written response, but I can tell you that over the last 3 months, we have been working very closely with the sector. We have supported them in having recruitment, fairs, events, so we're working very much alongside them. And what we have done is that we have provided funds for the domiciliary care sector, because that's where the problem is, to increase the wage from the real living wage up to £11 an hour. And that has certainly helped, we're advised, in recruitment and retention. And the number of care packages that we've been able to commission has gone up every month in the last 3 months since we have increased wages to £11 an hour. So we will be continuing to work very, very closely with the sector to support them in recruiting. It's a national problem. It's not just to do with Wirral. It is a national problem, but we will get a formal written response to that one as well.
Just for clarity, when you said £11 an hour, is that the price you're paying the contractor, was that the price contractors paid the employee?
Yeah, that's the amount that the employees will get. We pay obviously considerably more than that, the hourly rate to contractors.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Grace, for those questions. I'm sure the committee will be really interested to see the responses to your first two as well. That brings us on to item six, which is review of direct payments, and that's Bridget. You can take us through that report, please.
Yeah, thank you, Chair. Good evening, members. It's statutory duty as found by the Care Acts and the Children's Act to offer an alternative in terms of cash to a commissioned service that are eligible. Came to the committee in March earlier in the year to identify our concerns about the low number of people picking up direct payments. We've got 7,965 adults who are eligible for social care in the Wirral, and of that number, 535 people are in receipt of direct payment. So it's essential that that position changes. Since that report, we've undertaken a review. And the review has been comprehensive, but I think the important part of that review is the breadth of inclusion. So we've had people with lived experience on that group, we've had colleagues from both trusts on that group to make sure that as a system we're looking at how we resolve and improve the current position. The report and everything in the report supports rural priorities in a and is a key decision. Rather than, I suppose, finish the details of the report, there's something about direct payments that's really transformative. And I wanted to just give the committee a couple of experiences of how direct payments changes lives, and these are real stories. About 25 years ago, I worked with a young man who was about to make the transition from children's services to adult services. He was at a special school concerns about the risk presented, and there were lots of conversations about moving out of the area to go to a specialist placement. Mum and Dad absolutely resolute that the son was going to stay at home, so we arranged a direct payment for them, and they arranged and employed various PAs and family members. I bumped into him in a garden centre in the summer. This man is still supported by at least one of the PAs that he was supported by as a child. He has since got a job, he has his own home, he's obsessed with gardening, has a job actually in a market garden and attending to other people's gardens, and he's met Monty Don, which he was very proud to tell me. And it was one of those moments where I realised why I get up every day and have done for all these years. You know, to see someone thriving like that and have a very different life to what he might have done. And just another story really that I think is worth sharing. I worked with a young woman who had echolalia, which had learning disability as well, and essentially at 4 o'clock every morning, she'd sit on the end of my dad's bed and she'd repeat the same phrase over and over again until they had to go to work. They were at absolute breaking points, and again, there was a conversation about this young woman moving out there to an incredibly expensive placement. So we arranged for them to have a direct payment as well. So mum and dad got a break. They used the direct payment to increase a family member, because this young woman would only be receptive to certain people, and she was able to stay at home. You know, it could be a very different experience for her. She could have been miles away from home, living in an institution, missing a family, and we don't know what the impact would have been on her life, and it would have cost the council a huge amount of money. You know, so it can really make a difference, but it does deliver efficiencies as well. I really believe the man over around the table does, and certainly everyone in the review group agrees, that more people need the opportunity to take control of their lives and have greater flexibility. And just one of the story really, when I was in the council, was working with one of the solicitors employed by the council, and she developed a degenerative disease. She wanted to carry on working. She was passionate about her independence, and we arranged for her to have a direct payment. She needed the sort of support that would allow her to work, that would provide her the support to get up in the morning, that would enable her to travel around the borough. You know, this was someone that, you know, potentially would have lost her independence or income and everything else. So it's this level of transformation you can bring about with a direct payment. There's lots of different ways people can access direct payments. I'm not going to take you through those, but I've appended those as Appendix 1, I think, if you want to have a look at them after the meeting. So the report itself contains a series of recommendations and solutions. These have primarily been identified by people with lived experience who have direct payments, and practitioners who are assessing people and talking to people about the option of having a direct payment. And what has been clearly identified as a primary disincentive is the variable rates for direct payments. You know, they're very different, and direct payment rates for children are different. Again, I've got some of the figures in the report. I think, as was mentioned before by Councillor Nolan, the current hourly rate for DonCare has been increased to manage pressures. It's been funded by cost of care grants, and we've brought forward the rates and fees negotiations for next year. And again, as Councillor Nolan said, we've seen increased recruitment and increased retention. The cost to the council for an hour of DonCare is £20.17. The hourly rate for a DonCare worker is £11. What we'd like to do is align the DP hourly rate with those of DonCare, because the DP, a PA, who's employed by someone with a direct payment, earns £9.90. So we want to align that to £11, because it'll help retain staff as PAs. But I think critically as well, in terms of aligning the rates, what we see is a drop off at the point of transition. So children that are using DPs to children, their PAs get a higher rate, and that drops when they become adults. So the risk of losing their PA is a really critical point in their life. So we really want to reconcile those rates, and that's the recommendation I'm making to the committee, that we do that April next year. Identifying PAs is tricky. this is another primary concern that the group have reported. We undertook a soft market test and appended some details around the soft market test that we did. We had 8 people submit expressions of interest because we were looking for an organisation that would be able to operate a PA register that will identify PAs and match them to people, but also support, really provide really necessary support, because it's really hard if you suddenly go from living an ordinary life to becoming an employer, you know, because there's lots of tasks and skills associated with having a direct payment. But we also recognise that the council within the delivery arm, there's real potential there for that bit of the council to pick up this function as well. So what we'd like to do is bring a further report to this committee when we've looked at the benefits and detriments of the model that's going to deliver best, and to make a recommendation at a later date. I think the other issue that is extremely significant is appropriately trained staff. Identifying them is complex, and it really has been identified as a key barrier. And I think my concern about this is that because we don't have highly skilled staff, they're very skilled, but not highly skilled in terms of supporting people with very complex needs, we're excluding quite a significant group of people in our population from accessing the direct payment. And what the intention is to work with our trust to develop training framework so PAs have got the opportunity to access training opportunities, develop the skills, and potentially we could then look at introducing a stratified rates of pay. So the hourly pay would reflect the level of training expertise that the PAs have had. So we'd have a really highly skilled pool of staff at the disposal of people in Wirral. And what we'd also like to do is report on the progress with that piece of work, because it's quite complex. We've got to work with HR teams. We've really got to map out the skills that would warrant an increase in pay. So we'd like to include that in the report we're proposing we bring back. The other big issue of personal health budgets, I'm not sure how familiar people are with them. Very similar to a direct payment, it's the amount of money provided to support individuals' health and well-being needs. Some of the best examples are people that have continuing healthcare and people that have been detained in hospital under the Mental Health Act and are subject to a 117 appointed discharge. And again, that can be transformative as a direct payment for people in the areas that I described before. So we're doing quite a lot of work with the ICB at the minute around how we improve the take-up PHBs, because the two pieces of work come on alongside each other. So, and it's a key work stream of the strategy group, so we'll report on that when we bring the next iteration back. The other big area of disincentive of benefits, there's a real lack of clarity around benefits. So we've really promoted the info bank that the council holds and made sure that all that information is included there. But I think critically, assessors and reviewers who are going out to work with people to design support plans perhaps haven't got as much information as they need in that field. So we're making sure they're armed with that, and it's a mandatory part of the assessment process to have those conversations with people and making sure that benefits are being maximised. People with lived experience, a lot of people from Together We're Able, we're also doing a big piece of research in this area, because some councils do seem to have got this right, so they'll be making recommendations as well. In terms of another project, I think you know about it because we've presented on it before, is around 3 conversations, and this is an approach which is a different way of assessing people. So rather than going in and going through a tick box exercise, you sit down, you have a conversation with people, and you help them reflect on what's important to them, what personal assets they've got, what assets are available in the community. And we're already seeing a reduction in reliance on commissioned services. I just have to check the notes now so I don't get the figures wrong. I think within each team involved in this project, we've seen a 3%. intake for direct payments. Now, the adoption of this approach is currently being rolled out across both trusts, so we can see that trajectory continue. It's going to have a really positive impact. And just an example of how it's working, a call came into the duty team a couple of weeks ago, and it was a woman who had an hour's doncare support in the morning every day because she worked. And the doncare agency, for all sorts of reasons, wasn't able to operate in that area anymore. And she was at severe risk of losing her job. And the social worker was concerned because she would then have to identify an alternative direct payment provider, which she wouldn't be able to do quickly. But it transpired sitting down with her and talking to her, as I described, that this particular worker used to do her visit prior to doing her normal doncare run. So the conversation was, well, could you employ this woman as a direct payment? Both really nervous about it, they'd never been in that area before, but they agreed to do it. So this woman now has a PA who supports her in the morning, and she can go to work. And without that level of support, and if she'd lost a job, you know, there was a risk that she'd lose all of her independence, and she'd have to move back to the family home, which is not an outcome any of us will be able to see. So it's resonating across the system all the time. In terms of financial implications, we've talked about aligning the rates to £11 next April, and obviously in terms of financial implications, that will be subject to rates and fees negotiations next year. From a legal perspective, if we fail to offer direct payments as an alternative to commission support, we could risk failing to meet our statutory duties as a council. And I suppose on a personal note, because I do feel really passionately about this, flexibility with direct payments provides incredible flexibility and it enables more people to lead healthy and happy lives where they're really in control. You know, we've got more people who are working, we're creating jobs for more people, and it is really flexible, and I do believe it's really transformative. So thank you.
Thank you very much for that, Bridget. Just on a personal note, I can, from professional experience, tell many stories like yours, the examples you were giving, but also not just for younger people with disabilities who have jobs, but actually for older people as well. I've had a lot of experiences where families have undertaken their own employer and managing the direct payment, and the feedback from the families is, I feel so much better knowing that I've interviewed the people who are going to work with mum. I know when they're due to go in. I can speak to them if they don't turn up on time or if there's a problem. And people feel so much better knowing that they're actually in control. So it works as well for families too. So I do think there's some benefits with it. Do we have any questions or comments on the report?
Skills to meet the very complex needs of people. If we reflect that in our hourly rate, in terms of our efficiencies as a council, we'd still be making savings. The complicated bit of the work, and that's what we're focused on at the minute, is what constitutes a set of skills that would attract an increase in the hourly rate. So at the minute, it's an aspiration to pull that framework together, but until we've done that work, it's difficult to give any further clarity really on what those hourly rates might be.
Thank you.
I think it's good that that will be in a further report, but if you want to ask a question,
it's just a supplementary. So, if I've got that right, what he's saying is that the flat rate of the £11 won't be given to everybody, it will be given to people who can.
Yeah, okay. And the flat rate of £11 will be given to everybody, so we give them parity.
Yeah.
It's only rates above that that we need to require the skill set to attract a higher number.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
Well, thanks, Bridget. I just wondered, have we looked at other areas that are doing well with direct payments to see, you know, if there's anything we can learn from them about, you know, how they're operational?
Yes, we have. And I think what's been great about that is people with lived experience that have done a lot of that research. So we have got some learning. A lot of it is about communication. A lot of it is about what you put out there on your website. But I think one of the things that's been really interesting has been around digital property, and I think the point Councillor Nolan made about the profound impact a direct payment can have on an older person or on their family, because we make an assumption that everybody lives in the world of social media and accesses computers to look at websites, and they don't. So I think that's something that we're going to be really looking at promoting a very different kind of strategy.
Thank you.
Councillor Walsh
and
Councillor Gilchrist.
Thank you, Chair. I think it's brilliant. It's a really good idea. I think we should have done it sooner. So my only question is, can we do it sooner before April?
I think it'd be great. I'd like to do it. Yeah, I would have liked to have done it yesterday. But we need to align the increased hourly rate with the rates and fees negotiations. It's quite a complex process. But we will be doing it in April and no later than April. That's a good question.
Well, from what we've heard, this looks like doing something. It could be trailblazing. There's a degree of enthusiasm for our officers. On the face of it, the word register could appear to be a bit of a hurdle, but I think what we're looking at is indeed getting a system that inspires confidence in those who would refer to it. And the next stage of that is to make sure that the registry is operating with people in a way that does all the things we know, like DVS checks and training. The other positive is this mention of the work with the health trusts to have a scheme that has a level of training, produces a flow is the wrong word, but produces a flow of people into the profession, into the services. When we were talking about John Care earlier, I looked at some figures I was given, and there was like 1,206 people involved in domiciliary care in the middle of November. It had gone up from 1,181, but there's such a turnover in that career, that profession, that I was told that 54 had left, but 79 people had come in, which shows there was a growth. So if we can establish a system that people see that this is a good career, it's a good vocation, it's a calling, that you can be registered and you would be approached by people, and they would have confidence in the system. This looks something that could actually take off and help people, and also help us manage the needs of people effectively, because that's what we've been trying to do. The debate between domiciliary care being short of people, the care homes being short of people, and then switching around. We have this dialogue where we've had to place people in care homes because there haven't been enough domiciliary care people. So it is possible as our society to actually say we value people doing this kind of work, and the register ought to give individuals confidence that they're taking part in something that is recognised and is actually successful. That's, I think, what we're looking for, and I hope that we can get a time scale that will work and build this up, because for years we've been worried about the numbers of people taking direct payments, seeing the numbers stabilise, fall and then stabilise. And often thought there should be far more people taking advantage of direct payments. getting more. This issue of bringing your own manager, in inverted commas, and employing your own people must be quite a hurdle for somebody thinking, I've got that to do. So having a system that will enable them to have confidence that they'll get help in getting it up and running, that seems to us a good way forward. It seems to be a good way forward, and I think the committee would endorse all that's been said tonight.
Thank you, Chair. So, first of all, fantastic presentation, Bridget. Really exciting. From a personal point of view, when I was the chair of the Community Care Committee at the BMA, we actively were promoting a living wage for carers, and I think that's really good, and I welcome that. The one issue I have is around the data that EGK have produced around 40% of carers don't know what to do with medication and falls. I think that's about 45% and so on and so forth. So again, at the Community Care Committee, I was trying to sort of develop a register, which Councillor Gilchrist has just mentioned, about having a national register where carers are on a benchmark, where they have training around falls, they have training around drug management and around safeguarding, but also have regular appraisals and mentoring in the system. So unless we make this as a structured program in a career rather than something that people just dip in and out of, it is much better, because we need more carers, but more importantly, we need better quality carers, carers who have been trained, who know what to do with the vulnerable, most vulnerable society. So to that end, I just wondered what your views were. Thank you.
I think you made some excellent points, and I think from the needs to be the kind of support function of whoever provides the PA register, there need to be some core skills. But what I want to do is empower the people that are in a seat of the direct payment, or who are in effect the employees. Because it's the employee's responsibility to make sure their employees are equipped with the right skills. And there's nobody better than the individual, the representative or a family member, to describe what those needs are. You know, so if someone does need support with medication, is that employer confident that the person they explore has got the right skills to support them with medication? If they are at risk of falling, do they understand how to avoid falls and the sort of training we've had to help them with that? So I do agree, and I think that one of the things I'm most excited about, we want to make it a career choice, and I'm passionate about personal care and supporting people, but I think if you're giving people an offer of progression as well, you know, it kind of makes it even more appealing to people.
Thank you for that. Yeah, I have to say one of the probably most effective registers that I've seen operated is actually operated by a service user-led organisation. And it was, I suppose in some ways, a bit like a dating site, really, that, you know, people could look on site, look for what they wanted and what they needed for their own particular circumstances, as Bridget was saying, and the description of the PA who was looking for work would be there and saying what training they'd had for certain basics. Everybody had to have safeguarding, first aid, and health and safety, and then obviously DBS. And then over and above that, people may well have additional training. It was there, and people could look for somebody with specific training that they wanted. And that was effective, but, you know, it's horses for courses. Some authorities do it, some don't. Some tend to it out, some do it themselves. It varies widely. That's about me.
Bridget, thank you for your presentation. Enjoyed it, thank you. A quick question. Do you know how many of our 500 and whatever it is direct payment recipients, how many are children, how many are adults?
I can get that breakdown for you.
You don't?
It's precise.
Could you give me an indication? Is it half and half or more? From what you said earlier, that a lot of PAs leave when the child gets concerned that the £11 isn't going to be enough to incentivise them to stay on?
I think that's where we need to look at aligning the hourly rates.
I think that's where we really need to look at aligning the hourly rates to pay. The sort of next phase of the project is to engage further with children's services. So we've got that complete offer. I mean, currently there are more adults with a direct payment than there are children. And I think reflecting back on the three conversations model, where you're sitting down and talking to people rather than going into the formal assessment mode, the sooner you can start those conversations with families, the better. You know, so as soon as you can give them the power and control, the better. And I think, you know, the point Councillor Millen was making before about the most successful PA Finder services she's seen is led by the people that use PAs. We built into the invitation to expressions of interest the requirement that any agency that submitted an expression of interest would commit to including people with lived experience with a view to either those people being employed or those people at some point in the future assuming responsibility for that service. And we'd really want to involve children and families in that as well.
The 535 people referred to in this report are adults. So in addition to those 535, there are a significant number of children who receive direct payments. And Bridget's reporting includes reference to looking at aligning pay rates in the future and streamlining processes so that there are fewer differences between a child and an adult who receives an adult direct payment, and that will of course help with transition cases as well to remove some of those obstacles. But those 535 are adults.
Chair, thank you. I might just come back to one. Thank you for that. But we're going to have to tender for direct payment service and then take on all that responsibility. I mean, they're clearly not going to do it for nothing. There's a margin in that, and therefore that will eat into our savings. Are we concerned pay people more, obviously, and the margin for someone to do it will take us close to the 20, and therefore is it better keeping it in-house or not? Or thank you.
Thank you, Councillor Marnie. There are options with this, and we need to work through the options and the costs and impacts and benefits of those options. But certainly, if it were that we were seeking a decision to future committee to contract out that function, there would be a cost associated with it, yes. Yeah. But clearly, at the moment, it is a gap and it's a barrier to more people taking direct payment because becoming an employer and requiring all of that knowledge and ability to manage your employees is a gap at the moment. So we will have to provide that. If we're going to grow the numbers, and there will be a cost whether it's in-house or contracted out.
Yeah, I think that's what the certainly recommendation three is that there is a future report that explores the options whether we provide it in-house or whether we tender it out. So I think that's what we're saying is, you know, we need a further report, not something we're going to know right now. I'm happy to move those recommendations. Do I have a second of that? Councillor Davies, both Councillor Davies, Councillor Davies, but I am the margin. So that is that we will approve recommendations that direct payment hourly rates for personal assistance for adults be aligned to that domiciliary care worker from April 2023, that we will start work towards reconciling direct payment hour rates for adults and children, and that a future report will be brought to the committee exploring the options of either providing a council coordinated personal assistance register or a tender for a full direct payment service. Good, so that's moved and seconded. Does everyone agree?
Agreed.
Lovely, thank you all. Right, that takes us on then to item 7, and that is our Director of Public Health.
Chair, evening everybody. Right, so this is a paper that is basically to seek agreement to progress the recommissioning of the information and advice services, the Askers Wirral service. Just a little bit of background to it. The paper originally, work was undertaken in 2016, well before I arrived here, but basically that was to look at all the information and advice contracts across what was the CCG and the council at the time. And they brought them all together into one single front door information and advice service for the borough. So a 1 year contract was issued originally with the option to extend for 12 months as well. And that was awarded to Wallasey as the lead provider. And they deliver that in conjunction with Wirral James, Wirral Mencap and Wirral Mine, and they provide a more specialist service for more vulnerable groups. So the tender process was run during 2021 and the contract commenced 1st of April. It's due to 22. It's due to end on the 31st of March 24. So in order to comply with the procurement rules to comply with the procurement rules, we need to start that recommissioning process. So there was a piece of work that was undertaken, it was a cross-directorate piece of work led by Tim Games, and that was to look at the possibility of bringing some of those council services together as well in an external commission services under the Resilient Communities Programme. So that work has been undertaken and the current contract value is 1.1 million, it's a joint commission contract. So it's Wirral Council, Public Health, Housing, Children's Services and the local NHS, which is about 300k contribution. I think in the paper you can see that that it's been acknowledged that COVID and cost of living pressures have compounded the issues that are facing our communities and our residents, and that's reflected in a significant increase in the demand for the service to 180% over target and capacity currently. And what we're seeing as well is 40% more complex cases coming through the service, and clients coming with multiple needs as well. So you can see that the demand from that service from when it was originally set up has certainly expanded. This has been independently evaluated by Liverpool John Moores University, and the results are going to be available early 23. We'll use that to inform the service specification. There's a proposal to set up a cross-directorate partnership group which will establish which will be established to inform the development of the spec, to avoid any duplication and to ensure that we get value for money out of that contract. So there is a proposal in there to increase the financial envelope, and I think a number of you might have noticed that. That is mainly to give us that headroom when we sit down with partners and the NHS to look at what finances are available.